الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. أما بعد، first and foremost, I just want to thank everybody for coming, especially on a day where I just came from Tottenham right now. And I was teaching Bulugh al-Maram 11 hadith from the chapter of I'tikaf, Qiyam, and also Laylat al-Qadr. And just one time as I'm teaching, I hear people screaming outside. And then they told me they're the Tottenham fans. I was like, the game starts at 8 o'clock. And I've got a lecture, I need to be in Luton. So I don't know whether it was a good idea to do the lecture. So they said to me, are you going to cancel the lecture? I was like, no. Even though, subhanAllah, I thought barely anybody's going to turn up to the lecture. Jazakum Allah khair for attending. And because subhanAllah, the place was going crazy over there next to Masjid Sunnah in Tottenham. Anyways, my brothers and my sisters, alaykum salam. My brothers and my sisters, I changed the title of the topic to "Don't let the horse be more smarter than you." This is not a statement that I came with. In fact, it's a statement of Ibn al-Jawzi rahimahullah ta'ala. When he said, إِنَّ الْخَيْلَ إِذَا شَارَفَتْ نِهَايَةَ الْمِضْمَارِ بَدَلَتْ قَصَارَ جُهْدَهَا لِتَفُوزِ بِالسِّبَاقِ. When the horse is about to reach the end of the race, it will exert all of its efforts in order to try and win the race. So then Ibn al-Jawzi rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, فَلَا تَكُنِ الْخَيْلُ أَفْطَنَ مِنْكَ. Don't let the horse be more intelligent than you. فَإِنَّكَ إِذَا لَمْ تُحْسِنَ الْإِسْتِقْبَالِ لَعَلَّكَ تُحْسِنُ الْوَدَعِ. Perhaps if you did not do well in welcoming the month of Ramadan, inshallah you will do better bidding it farewell. You know, my brothers and my sisters, a couple of weeks ago I was on BBC.com. I go on BBC.com sometimes in order to keep up with current affairs, because you can't be backwards, right? Somebody who's given da'wah, he needs to know what's happening around him, right? It's very important. What Theresa May is saying, what's not happening, Brexit, all of that stuff. Recently my dad was like, you're going to get kicked out of the country because I'm a Dutch citizen. And I had to get residency, alhamdulillah, I got it in the end. Point of the matter is, it's important that you keep up to date with what is going on around you. What's changing, all of these rainbow stuff that, you know, developing every now and again here and there, you need to know what's going on. Guys, know what I'm talking about, that rainbows. When I scrolled right at the end of the article, because this article was posted in one of the WhatsApp groups, I came across a video. I came across this video of a man diving. But where was he diving? Was he diving into the pool? He was diving on a running racing track. It was a 400 meter relay race. As he got to the end of the race, guys, just as he's competing now, it's him and another guy. This guy was American. I think the other guy was American as well. Just as the race is about to finish, what do they normally do? They do their heads like that, right? So the head can cross the line quicker than the other one. This guy ended up diving. Some of you guys may have seen it. I was like, wow. This guy dived. You know, the same guy, the guy dives into the swimming pool, this guy dived like that. And he ended up winning the race. What is the point of me mentioning this, guys? It's about how the race finishes, right? The guy is exerting his efforts, unless you're like Usain Bolt. One time I tried to use this example in a lecture, I think this was last year. One guy was like, nah, Usain Bolt, he walks to the end. You guys know Usain Bolt, right? But what do? They exert their efforts right at the end of the race, he tries to win it. So Ibn al-Jawzi rahimahullah ta'ala is saying to you, don't let the horse, the animal, be more smart, because even an animal does that. Right at the end, when he's being whipped, that horse is going to try and win the race. It's why also Ibn Taymiyyah, rahimahullah ta'ala, he says,
العبرة بكمال النهايات لا بنقص البدايات. The lesson lies in the perfection of the conclusion, not how or not the shortcomings that one came with at the beginning of it. We find these races, right? Sometimes he starts with a very, very slow pace and then he ends up winning. Also, Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala in his kitab Madarij al-Salikin, he says, أهل الاستقامة أشد اجتهادا في نهاياتهم أو في نهاياتهم أشد اجتهادا من بداياتهم. The people who are steadfast, the people who are upright, they strive harder in the endings of the ibadah that they do more than how it starts. This is why one time I had, subhanAllah, ended up coming together and falling into perspective. Sheikh Muhammad Mukhtar al-Shanqiti, some of you guys may have heard about him. When it comes to heart softeners, he will tear your heart apart. Allahumma barik. I've seen commoners, 9-to-5 random regular guys, saying, the whole week his iman goes down, goes and attends the lecture of the sheikh, every 2 weeks he comes to Jeddah. Huh? And then it's like the battery that gets charged again. Comes to Medina once a month. Some of his videos have been translated in English. People say stuff about him that he's got tasawwuf and whatnot, which is all empty speech, has absolutely no basis. But this man, my brothers and my sisters, he's something else. I struggle to find anybody to come as close to him when it comes to his memorization. And also he's someone who has ibadah. His ibad, he's something else. And when he speaks, it really, really touches your heart. He said that one time he sat with a couple of individuals and he asked them with regards to the issue of khushu'. Most people will say that they feel khushu' right at the beginning, right? And then as he's getting to the end of the salah, what happens? He remembers what he ate last week. Huh? Where's my car keys? Or what did she do? My kid, this, right under the salah. And before you even know it, he's become distracted. His salah, is in tatters. Because we know not everybody, guys, they end up getting the same reward when it comes to the salah. Muhammad might pray, Harun might pray, but they might not necessarily be the same when it comes to the reward. People get distracted, their mind goes. So the Messenger of Allah عليه وسلم, he said, إِنَّ الرَّجُلَ لَيَنْصَرِفُ مِنْ صَلَاتِهِ. A man is praying and he leaves the salah. وَمَا كُتِبَ لَهُ مِنْ صَلَاتِ إِلَّا عُشْرُهَا. And that which he ended up getting from the salah is 1/10. Some ended up getting maybe 20%, some 30%, some 40%, إِلَى نِصْفِهَا. Some only maybe 50%. Do you think the one who's thinking about his wife, what he done last night, or what he was doing this morning, is the same as the one who's fully concentrating in his salah? So he was talking about the ending of the prayer, and he was saying that what sometimes tends to happen to an individual, if he has khushu' at the beginning, he ends up becoming deluded, deceived. He's got khushu' now, oh, maybe I'm fine now, you know? Anyways, point of the matter is, my brothers and my sisters, it's how it ends. That's what really, really matters. This is why Hassan al-Basri rahimahullah ta'ala, the great tabi'in, he said, أحسن فيما بقي يغفر لك ما مضى. Try to perfect that which remains, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive you for that which has passed. If you feel like, my brothers and my sisters, you've wasted your Ramadan, there is still a lot of hope. And then he goes on to say, فَغْتَنِمْ مَا بَقِي. Try to seize this opportunity that you have. فَإِنَّكَ لَا تَدْرِي مَتَى تُدْرِكُكَ رَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ. For indeed you don't know when the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to come unto you. رُبَّمَا تَكُونُ فِي آخِرِ سَاعَةٍ مِنْ رَمَضَانِ. Perhaps it might be in the last hour of Ramadan. If you show Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you really, really want it, Is there any reason Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to reject you? Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَنْ لَمْ يَسْأَلِ لَا يَغْضَبْ عَلَيْهِ. Whoever doesn't ask Allah Azza wa Jal, Allah becomes angry at him. So why would Allah Azza wa Jal reject you? But it's down to us to really show Allah Azza wa Jal that we really, really want it right then. These remaining days, my brothers and my sisters, we should be crying our eyes out. So Ibn Rajab al-Hanbali rahimahullah ta'ala, in his wonderful kitab, Lata'if al-Ma'arif, he says, كَيْفَ لَا تَجْرِي لِلْمُؤْمِنِ عَلَى فِرَاقِ رَمَضَانَ دُمُوعٌ وَهُوَ لَا يَدْرِي هَلْ يَبْقَى لَهُ فِي عُمُرِهِ مِنْ رُجُوعٍ or مِنْهُ رُجُوعٍ. How is it that one doesn't weep or he doesn't become saddened that Ramadan is about to depart? That Ramadan, my brothers and sisters, is about to depart. And he doesn't know whether he's going to get another return. Guys, I personally know people who have died just before the month of Ramadan. I don't know about you. Brothers have been stabbed. You've probably seen some of the work that our brother Imran is doing. Kids are stabbing one another like it's happy days. It's become normal. Many people have been stabbed before the month of Ramadan. The fact that we don't cry and we don't, it really doesn't trigger us. That this could be our last Ramadan. Some of you guys remember what happened in the Grenfell Tower, right? In the month of Ramadan, the Finsbury Park shootings, that incident took place. When that white supremacist, that's what they call him, right? Huh? Ended up running into the Muslims. Maybe there was from amongst them who didn't have in the back of their mind that this is going to be what their last Ramadan. So Ibn al-Jawzi rahimahullah ta'ala in his kitab al-Tabsira, he said, لو قيل لأهل القبور تمنوا لتمنوا يوما في رمضان. If it was said to the people of the grave, make a wish. You know what they would wish, my brothers and my sisters? They would wish for a day in the month of Ramadan. When I looked at this first, mashallah, it looked like a very nice quote. You know, Ibn Rajab rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, صِيَامٌ فِي رَمَضَانٍ أَفْضَلٌ مِنْ أَلْفِ صِيَامٍ فِي غَيْرَ رَمَضَانٍ. He quotes Ibrahim al-Nakha'i, the great tabi'i, where he said, a siyam, one day fasting, is better than a thousand fasting outside the month of Ramadan. تَسْبِيحَةٌ, one person saying, Subhanallah, أَفْضَلٌ مِنْ أَلْفِ تَسْبِيحَةٍ فِي غَيْرَ رَمَضَانٍ. It's better than a thousand outside the month of Ramadan. وَرَكَعَةٌ فِي رَمَضَانٍ أَفْضَلُ مِنْ أَلْفِ رَكَعَةٍ فِي غَيْرَ رَمَضَانٍ. One raka'ah in the month of Ramadan is better than a thousand what? Raka'at outside the month of Ramadan. And you see now how it makes sense. Why they would say such thing. And how much they value the issue of Ramadan. And this is exactly the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, guys. Forget about anybody else. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who was walking on the face of the earth without no past sins and no future sins. إِنَّا فَتَحْنَا لِكَ فَتْحًا مُبِينًا لِيَغْفِرَ لَكَ اللَّهُ مَا تَقَدَّ مِنْ ذَنْبِكَ وَمَا تَأَخَرَ. We are going to give you an opening. What was this opening? The conquest of Mecca. لِيَغْفِرَ لَكَ اللَّهُ مَا تَقَدَّ مِنْ ذَنْبِكَ وَمَا تَأَخَرَ وَيُتِمَّ نِعْمَتَهُ عَلَيْكَ وَيَهْدِيكَ صِرَاطًا مُسْتَقِيمًا. So he can forgive your past and also your future sins and complete his favor upon you. He was walking on the face of this earth, guys, and he had no sins. We know in the last 10 days, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he would burn himself up so much. In the first 20, he would interchange between sleeping some parts of the night and some parts of the night would be praying. In the last 10, Aisha said to him when she saw how swollen his feet became, why do you do this to yourself when your past and future sins have been forgiven? He said, أَفَلَا أَكُونُ عَبْدًا شَكُورًا. Shall I not be a thankful slave? Aisha said about him, إِذَا دَخَلَ العشر الأخير من رمضان. When the last 10 days used to kick in the month of Ramadan, he would what? He would tighten his izar, his lower garment, his lungi. When somebody they call it ma'wis, right? You guys know what ma'wis is? Huh? You guys somebody? Ma'wis, you know what ma'wis is, right? Naam. Recently I said ma'wis in one of the Somali masajid. One guy came up to me, he goes, no, don't say ma'wis, say go. Say gunti. And then some other Somali guy was there as well. Because we'll see what we're talking about. You're right, don't worry. Huh? Because I got broken Somali, you see, I just bring in some stuff here and there. And they get excited when I do. Point of the matter is, guys, he would tie it. This is figurative speech. Meaning he would up his game. He would put in gear 5, he was in gear 4. He would improve his performance. وَأَحْيَى لَيْلَهُ. And he would also do what? He would bring the night to life. When you bring the night to life, was there something that was dead that you brought to life? Huh? As they say, right? Sleeping is the brother of what? It's the brother of death. النوم أخو الموت, as they say. So by him not going to sleep, he's bringing it to life. وَأَيْقَضَ أَهْلَهُ. And he would also not just think about himself, he would do it collectively with his wives. زوجاته الطاهرات. His blessed noble wives, he would wake them up as well. Because he cared and he knew the responsibility that he has. If one's not going to advise, my brothers, pay attention to this, and sisters, he's not going to advise his relative with regards to the deen, then in essence, even if you bring them all the issues that they need in the dunya, in essence, you haven't been there for them. You really haven't. You've in fact forsaken them. Because the real advice, the one who really, really cares, is the one who cares about your religion. Sometimes he advises us and we don't want to hear it. He's doing his job. He's doing what Allah Azza wa Jalla wants him to do. كُلُّكُمْ رَاعِي وَكُلُّكُمْ مَسْؤُولَ عَنْ رَعِيَتِهِ. Every single one of you is a shepherd. And every single one of you is in charge of his flock. الرَّجُلُ رَاعٍ عَلَى أَهْلِ بَيْتِهِ وَهُوَ مَسْؤُولٌ عَنْ رَعِيَتِهِ. The father, he's the shepherd of the house. And he's in charge of his what? Children, his flock. وَالْمَرْأَةُ رَاعِيَةٌ عَلَى بَيْتِ أَهْلِ أَهْلِهَا وَعَلَى وَلَدِهِ وَمَالِهِ وَهِيَ مَسْؤُولَةٌ عَنْهُ. The wife, she's in charge of the kids. And she's also looking after his house and his wealth. Everybody has been given that responsibility. Allah, what did he say? يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا قُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ وَأَهْلِيكُمْ نَارًا. Save yourself and save your family from the fire. In another hadith, and this hadith is deep, guys. It really is. We all know what a wonderful feeling for most of us. Not you kids. The wonderful feeling that one feels when he gets married. I haven't got any kids, but just about every guy that you speak about as kids says one of the, it's even a better feeling the moment you have a kid. Am I wrong, guys? I'm tough.
You're right.
When that kid comes out, you know, but he comes, my brothers, with their sisters.
What they think I'm being, you know? I have to say sisters as well.
I switch it off. It comes with a responsibility. That's why the Messenger of Allah عليه وسلم, he said, مَا مِنْ عَبْدٍ يَسْتَرْعِيهِ اللَّهُ رَعِيَّةً يَمُوتُ يَوْمَ يَمُوتُ وَغَاشٌ لِرَعِيَتِهِ إِلَّا حَرَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ الْجَنَّةِ. Never does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala place a responsibility upon any individual. And then he dies while having deceived his children. Don't think to yourself, how can one who loves his kid deceive them? And it's the point that I raised earlier. How does he deceive them? وَلَمْ يُحِطْهَا بِنُصْحِهِ. He did not advise them accordingly. إِلَّا حَرَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ الْجَنَّةِ. Except Allah Azza will make the Jannah haram upon the individual. It's tough, brothers and sisters. It really is. I see what parents of kids go through. Just now I was in my cousin's house and the mom was crying. She was crying. If I was a mahram to her, I'd probably gone and hugged her. But I wasn't a mahram. Cares so much about kids, but there's one of them who's driving her crazy. It's a painful experience, wallahi, to witness that. It really is. But one has to go through that struggle. It comes with that what? That responsibility. So if one's not going to advise them, my brothers and my sisters, in this month, in these most blessed nights, when is he going to advise them? As in sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, hadith Abi Hurayra, he said, رَحِمَ اللَّهُ رَجُلًا قَامَ مِنَ اللَّيْلِ فَصَلَّ وَأَيْقَدَ مْرَأَتَهُ فَصَلَّتْ. May Allah Azza wa Jal have mercy upon the man who woke up in the night and he prayed. And then he woke up his family, his wife. فَصَلَّتْ. And she also prayed with him. Masallah is making dua for that person. Allah has mercy upon the individual. فَإِنْ أَبَتْ. When she refuses, he gets water and he sprinkles it on her face. وَرَحِمَ اللَّهُ مْرَأَةً قَامَتْ مِنَ اللَّيْلِ فَصَلَّتْ. May Allah have mercy upon the woman who woke up in the night. She prayed. وَأَيْقَدَتْ زَوْجَهَا. She also ended up what? Waking up her husband. فَإِنْ أَبَى نَضَحَتْ فِي وَجْهِ الْمَاءِ. If you refuse, she would get water and she would sprinkle it in his face. May Allah Azza wa Jal all give us wives and husbands like that. This is something my brothers and my sisters should really try to aspire for. We really should. And try to be like. So my brothers and my sisters, this final opportunity that we have, Messenger Allah has told us about the salah. إِذَا قَامَ أَحَدُكُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِ فَصَلِّ صَلَاتِ مُوَدِّعِينَ. When you stand up for prayer, pray the farewell prayer. Please, who can tell me what the farewell prayer is? Is there a sixth prayer called the farewell prayer? Like Dhuhr, Asr, Fajr? What is this prayer?
Pray as your last, imagine as your last prayer.
Remember? Pray as if it is your last prayer. فَتَحَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكَ. Pray as if it's your last prayer. Guys, the one who's been put on death row. Sometimes they give an opportunity to do something at the end, right? The guy who prays that prayer, do you think it's going to be like any other prayer? Huh? Is it going to be like every other prayer? The guy's going to try and perfect it, right? It's his last prayer, he's about to meet his Lord. We've been told that with regards to the prayer, that we pray 5 times a day. Between Dhuhr and Asr is maybe 4 hours. So how about our Ramadan, guys? The Taraweeh, the du'as that are being expected throughout the whole period of fasting. Fasting that we're doing this Ramadan, that's a blessing upon us. Do we have a guarantee to meet the next Ramadan? Wallahi, we don't. We really don't. So my brothers and my sisters, don't let the horse be more smarter than yourself. One of the ways to know, my brothers and my sisters, or from the signs, as they say, as to whether you know your Ramadan took a positive direction or it went left wing. It went completely opposite direction, negatively. On the day of Eid, my brothers and my sisters, on the day of Eid, It could determine whether your Ramadan, inshallah, might get accepted or not. We all see this, right? What happens on Ramadan? Right end. The night of Eid, the night before the Salah, Salat al-Eid. Some of you guys may have seen some of these videos online. Previous years, we went to Southall. Last year I was in a place called, call it Waterpool, was it? Water? In Birmingham. Water Lily Road. Lady Pool Road. Wallahi, you think to yourself, yes, the shayateen have been released. You know, destroying something, my brothers and my sisters, is more easy than building something. Am I wrong for saying that? Wallahi, your Ramadan can get destroyed in a moment. All of that hard work for 30 days could go down the drain. determining your Ramadan could be that night, my brothers and my sisters, how you conduct yourself. You see, madness breaking out. From the moment you're in the masjid, people are shouting, huh? You think, what just happened? And you can see the big shouting been released. You go to these places, wallahi, brothers are smoking weed in my face. Sisters have thrown off their hijabs. Sisters are driving Ferraris. I've seen a sister with my own eyes. On water, what's it again?
Ladypool
Road. Wallahi, she had no hijab. She's just blasting the music. She was in a Ferrari, guys. She went round and she went round and she went round, showing off the car. The other day I read a statement of Ibn Rajab al-Hanbali in his kitab Lataif al-Ma'arif. You know what he said, my brothers and my sisters? لَيْسَ الْعِيدُ لِمَنْ لَبِثَ الْجَدِيدِ إِنَّمَا الْعِيدُ لِمَنْ طَاعَتُهُ تَزِيدُ. Eid isn't, the real Eid isn't, the one who ended up wearing new clothes. In fact, indeed, the real Eid is the one whose ta'at, whose obedient act increased. And then he says, لَيْسَ الْعِيدُ لِمَنْ تَجَمَّلَ بِاللِّبَاسِ وَالرُّكُوبِ. Eid isn't the one who beautified himself with nice clothes and nice flashy cars. Think to yourself, imagine if Ibn Rajab saw this. Cars get rented out when? On the last night, right? And hotels are booked out. Because the guy's been holding himself from the girlfriend all of these days. On the last 10 nights, and guys, I'm telling you this, me coming from a background, last 10 nights, you know what's being planned? The haram that's going to happen on the day of Eid. وَلَا تَكُونُ كَلَّتِي نَقَضَتْ غَزْلَهَا مِنْ بَعْدِ قُوَّةٍ أَنْكَاثَ. Do not be like the old lady who tied, who knitted, who tailors. All her hard work, as Allah tells us in the Quran, what did she end up doing? She ended up just, after all of the hard work, she just ripped it. Eid, my brothers and my sisters, it will determine. This is why Ali ibn Abi Talib, my brothers and my sisters, Ali ibn Abi Talib, on the night before the Eid Salah, last night of Ramadan, he would call out, Ya layta shi'ri, he would shout it, Man hadha al-maqbool fanuhanni. Who is this person whose Ramadan was accepted so we can congratulate him? وَمَنْ هَذَا الْمَحْرُومْ فَنُعَزِّيهِ. Ali ibn Abi Talib wanted to pay his condolences to the person who wastes Ramadan. Are you listening? Are you busy with the kid? Who is this person who has been deprived of his Ramadan being accepted? He wanted to pay ta'seer with the same Somali. Huh? When somebody dies, you pay your condolences to his family, right? We go and visit him, we show how sad we are and whatnot, and then we leave. Ali ibn Abi Talib wants to do that to someone who has wasted his Ramadan. Wallahi, that 30 days can easily be destroyed. It really can. Could just go down the drain like that. Because of what we do on that one night. So Abu Waqi' ibn al-Jarrah, my brothers and my sisters, the teaching Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah ta'ala, he said the zakat al-fitr. We all pay zakat al-fitr, right? Saghiran kana aw kabira. Whether he's young, whether he's old. And even in madhab Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, it's actually sunnah to pay zakat al-fitr, for the embryo that's still inside the stomach. Something that Ibn Umar ibn Abbas radiallahu used to give fatwa. Point of the matter is, you know what he says? The zakat al-fitr is like the sajdatay as-sahu. When the imam makes a mistake, he does two prostrations at the end. Why does he do that? Who can tell me? Huh? Adiga? Yes. When the imam, sometimes he does two sujood at the end. Why? Huh? You? Why does the imam just randomly? How many raka'at is duhur? Huh? Four, right? Why does the imam sometimes, rarely, he ends up doing two at the end, two sujoods?
two prostrations. He made a mistake. He does that in order to cover the mistake of the salah. Are you with me, guys? Because maybe there was a naqs, there was a deficiency. Maybe there was what? Something extra he done. Maybe because he ended up having shak, the doubt in the salah. Am I wrong, guys? He says the zakatul fitr is like that. One pays zakatul fitr, he has the same position as the issue of what? Sajdatay as-sahw. All the deficiencies, the shortcomings that we came with, this is inshallah ta'ala going to cover it. That's why Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, وَطُهْرَةٌ لِلصَّائِمِ مِنَ اللَّغْوِ وَالرَّفَثِ. This is a purification for the one who was fasting from all types of idle speech that he may have got himself involved in. We should be following up with what? With an extra good deed, right? The lesson that we learn from this statement, guys, is that one should not become deceived with the action that he does. In fact, he should follow it up. But today, instead of us following up, we're destroying it on the day of Eid. On the day of Eid, my brothers, this is what we take from this lesson. From the alamat, the signs of an accepted action, he follows up one good deed with another. And this is exactly what he's telling us and teaching us. Zakatul Fitr is meant to be covering your mistakes and your shortcomings. Not be destroying it on that day. A very nice benefit, guys, that Ibn Rajab al-Hanbali took out from the dua. That the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to who? Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. We all know it. Our kids know it. Allahumma innaka afuun tuhibbul afwa fa'fu anni. Something very powerful he derived from there is, he says, إِنَّمَا أَمَرَ بِسُؤَالِ الْعَفْوِ فِي لَيْلَةِ الْقَدْرِ بَعْدَ الْإِجْتِهَادِ فِي الْأَعْمَالِ فِيهَا وَفِي لَيَالِ الْعَشْرِ. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam only commanded Aisha. Well, like, guys, this is a very, very powerful point. Very powerful. Please pay attention to this. If we look at who is advising and who is the one being advised, Aisha radiya unrestrictedly, she was from the greatest of women to ever walk on the face of this earth, right? From the people of Jannah. She just came out of Ramadan. She's been praying. She's been fasting. She's been making dua. She's been doing dhikr. What does he tell her? Go ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to pardon me. Narajabi says, he only told her that after working so hard throughout the month on Laylatul Qadr and also on the days before that. لأن العارفين, the smart, intelligent individual. يَجْتَهِدُونَ فِي الْأَعْمَالِ, they strive really, really hard. ثُمَّ لَا يَرَوْنَ لِأَنفُسِهِمْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا وَلَا حَالًا وَلَا مَقَالًا. They don't see themselves having achieved anything. They see themselves to be individuals who have fallen short. What do they do then? فَيَرْجِعُونَ إِلَى سُؤَالِ الْعَفُوِ كَحَالِ الْمُذْنِبِ الْمُقَسِّرِ. They rush back to Allah in forgiveness, begging him the same way the one who sinned. I'm going to ask you guys a question. A guy committed zina. Somebody fell into zina. If he's intelligent, what is he going to do? He's going to make tawbah to Allah Azza wa Jal. He's going to wake up in the last of the night and he's going to cry, break down, be remorseful. And he's kadhalik. Ibn Rajab says, that should be the state. If you want to be from the awliya Allah, the saints, the greatest of the people, when you're done with the ibadah, Allah gave you the success, right? He helped us. He aided and assisted us. One should be rushing back to Allah Azza wa Jal, begging Him for forgiveness. That's after a great righteous act one has done. That's why Imam Sa'di rahimahullah in his poem, where he talks about the sifat of the awliya, he says, فعل الفرائض والنوافل دعبهم مع رؤية التقصير والنقصان. The way of the awliya is that they do righteous actions. That is obligatory upon them, and also that is a sunnah upon them. While at the same time, they see themselves falling short. They see themselves that there is room for improvement. One can easily become deluded. Laylatul Qadr khayru min alfi shahr. I stood up on the 27th night. It's better than 1,000 months.
I'm sorted for the next year, brother. That is not the way of the awliya. If you look what Ibn al-Qayyim, subhanAllah, in his kitab, Madaj Salikin, he says, علامة قبول العمل احتقاره واستقلاله وصغره. From the signs of an accepted action is that he belittles it. He sees that he hasn't done much. Looks down on it. And then he follows up one good deed with another. I'm going to ask you guys a question. What's the first thing that we do after the salah? The dua, right? Huh? We do dua. Now guys, seriously. Huh? What do you say? Huh? Akseem mumbling. Astaghfirullah. Jazakallah khair. Alayka nur. First thing that we say, astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah. As it came in the hadith of Thabit. The message, he said, كان لي صلاة إذا انصرف من صلاتي استغفر الله ثلاثة. He just came out of the prayer, guys. He was standing in front of Allah Azza wa Jal. What did he follow that up with? A good deed. So Ibn al-Qayyim mentioned all these examples. When a guy goes out on Hajj, how does he come back? Huh? But what's his state now? He had all these sins. He went out on Hajj. What does he come back like? Newborn baby, we all know that, right? مَنْ حَجَّ وَلَمْ يَفْرُثْ وَلَمْ يَفْسُخْ رَجَعَ كَيُومِ وَلَدَتُ أُمَّهُ. Whoever does Hajj and he doesn't fall into any obscenity, any fisk, this individual is going to come back like a newly born baby. Newly born babies. Clean slate. You guys in the back, do you have a back problem? Huh? You want to come sit next to me? I'll get you a chair as well. You want to sit next to me? Huh? I'm going to ask you guys a question. When Jibreel came to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, how far was he sitting from him? You don't know, the one next to you.
Me?
Yeah, you. Huh? What about the one next to him? You don't know. Who can give me the answer quickly? Huh?
He was holding the hand of Prophet Sallallahu
Alaihi Wasallam. Knees. His knees were touching the knees. So you want to come touch my knees? Huh? So what we take from that, by the way, I'm not the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, that when somebody comes to teach you, give you a reminder, you try to get as close as possible. Forgive me for that, yeah, I tend to do that, you know? Sorry. Point of the matter is, going back to that hadith, Messallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Hajjah, whoever does Hajj, and he didn't fall into any obscenity, any fisk. He comes back like a newly born baby. Clean slate. He has no sins. What does Allah Azza wa Jalla tell us? فَإِذَا أَفَضْتُم مِّنْ عَرَفَاتٍ فَاذْكُرُوا اللَّهَ عِنْدَ الْمَشْعَرِ الْحَرَامِ وَاذْكُرُوا كَمَا هَدَاكُمْ وَإِنْ كُنْتُمْ مِّنْ قَبْلِهِ لَمِنَ الضَّالِّينَ ثُمَّ أَفِيضُوا مِنْ حَيْثُ أَفَاضَ النَّاسُ وَاسْتَغْفِرُوا اللَّهَ. Allah tells that individual to do istighfar. Astaghfirullah, astaghfir. We only do istighfar when? Tawbah, tawbah. When we fall into a mistake, we say tawbah, tawbah. We say astaghfirullah. Am I wrong? We seek repentance from the sins that we made. Only at the time of sinning. After Ramadan, what do? We just fasted for 30 days. Huh?
We don't fast.
We don't fast. Okay, after the day of Eid. What can you do in Shawwal, the month after it? 6 days of Shawwal. Following up one good deed with another. If you look at the sifat to Ibad al-Rahman, guys, in Surah Al-Furqan. In Surah Al-Furqan, we all know the famous ayat which talk about the characteristics of Ibad al-Rahman, the servants of the Most Merciful One. If you look at the first couple of characteristics, my brothers and sisters, it makes it very clear to you what the Ramadan is trying to do. Ramadan is trying to make you become from the best of the people. What did the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say about the individual who comes and insults you? What'd you say? Inni Simon, right? إِذَا جَاءَ يَوْمَ صَوْمِ أَحَدِكُمْ فَلَا يَرْفَثْ وَلَا يَسْخَبْ. As the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, when the day that your fasting comes, do not be sulky or somebody who speaks in a very filthy way, guys. Don't be like that. If somebody comes and insults you, you say, Inni sa'imun. You ignore those who are ignorant. The first characteristic we are told in the sifat, the characteristics of Ibadur Rahman is what? وَعِبَادُ الرَّحْمَنِ الَّذِينَ يَمْشُونَ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ هَوْنًا وَإِذَا خَاطَبَهُمُ الْجَاهِلُونَ قَالُوا سَلَامًا. When those who are ignorant speak to them, they say peace and they keep it moving. What was the second characteristic? وَالَّذِينَ يَبِيتُونَ لِرَبِّهِمْ سُجَّدًا وَقِيَامًا. Those who spend their nights in what? Prostration and also doing ruku'. What did the Ramadan help us do? He got us into the mood of praying the qiyam. Are you with me, guys? That was the first two characteristics that was mentioned. And they are two things that Ramadan is trying to help us do. Continue these acts after the month of Ramadan. وَالَّذِينَ يَقُولُونَ رَبَّنَا اصْرِفْ عَنَّا عَذَابَ جَهَنَّمْ إِنَّ عَذَابَهَا كَانَ غَرَامًا. Making dua, another characteristic, they ask Allah, remove the, or keep the fire away from us. What have we been doing throughout the month of Ramadan? We've been hearing, right, the Imam said, Allahumma ihtiq riqabana min an-nar. Oh Allah, free our necks from the fire. Making dua as well. Rabbana atina fi dunya hasanatan wa fi al-akhirati hasanatan wa qina adhab an-nar. Wal-ladhina idha anfaqu lam yusrifu wa lam yaqtaru wa kana bayna dhalika qawama. What was the fourth characteristic? Spend. They spend in a modest, balanced way. What does the month of Ramadan, he gets us in which type of attitude and mood to be spending? Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, kana min ajwad an-nas. He was from those who were the most generous. And in the month of Ramadan, he was even more generous. Do you see, my brothers and my sisters, what Ramadan is trying to do? Ramadan is not just a month, it's just not an ibadah, us doing these acts in the month of Ramadan, that is seasonal. We ain't part-time Muslims. It's Ramadan is like that wish, you know, work experience. What do you do right when you start a new job? What do we call it again? Training, right? Do training and then you carry on. The Ramadan trains you in order to become a better Muslim and to carry this on. Then he also gives another example, guys. Imam Al-Qayyim rahimahullah, after the wudu, what do we say after the wudu? An ibadah that we just done. There's a narration that states when a person makes wudu on his hands, his face, what falls off? Your sins. Your sins are falling off. But what did the Messenger still advise with? What do you read? مَا مِنْكُمْ مِنْ أَحَدٍ يَتَوَضَّأُ فَيُسْبِغُ الْوُضُوَى ثُمَّ يَقُولُ أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَأَشْهَدُ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا عَبْدُهُ وَرَسُولُهُ إِلَّا فُتِحَتْ أَبْوَابُ الْجَنَّةِ الثَّمَانِيَةِ يَدْخُلُ مِنْ أَيِّهَا شَاءَ. He says his dua, the eight doors of Jannah are opened up for him. But what does he still have to say? اللهم اجعلني من التوابين واجعلني من المطهرين. Oh Allah, make me from those who repent. Constantly come back to you. Can you see, my brothers and my sisters, how the end of Ramadan comes in relevance to the beginning of Shawwal after the month of Ramadan? And how this is now in relation to becoming from the greatest of the ibad. Ibadur Rahman. This Ramadan, I really badly wanted to go through them ayat. At the end of Surah Al-Furqan, one of the nicest ayat that you can read, and one of the nicest things that you can act upon. But I just didn't get a chance. Hopefully, inshallah, in these few, I've done some justice to it. That we understand the relation that it has with the month of Ramadan. We ask Allah, Azza wa Jal, my brothers and my sisters, to benefit us from what we heard, and to make us from those who benefit from the speech and don't just pull it through one ear and take it out of the other. And I really, really appreciate you guys coming. I did mention at the beginning, and I'll mention again because a lot of people ended up coming. I really didn't think anybody was going to turn up. Some of the students, I just came from Tottenham. Masjid Sunnah is right on Whitehall Lane. As I was teaching today, Bulugh al-Maram, min adillat al-ahkam al-hadith, from this immense kitab of Ibn Hajar on fiqh, I can hear people going crazy outside. I was like, what's going on? Some of them were like, oh, these are Tottenham supporters. Today is the Champions League final. I was like, that's at 8 o'clock. It's the same time as my lecture. Huh? And they were like, are you going to cancel it then? Because no one's going to come though. He's like, no, I'm going to carry on. I'm going to carry on. So I really, really appreciate that. No one supports Tottenham here, eh? All of you guys support Luton and Millwall. Eh? I remember one brother from the Magic saying this to me, Millwall fans and Luton fans used to kill each other. Does that still happen? Huh? Allah Akbar. Point of the matter is, Jazakum Allah Khairah for coming and benefiting. I really, really appreciate it, and I ask Allah Azza wa Jal to benefit us from what we heard and to make these last few days that we really, really benefit. And let's not forget one another in dua. We are all in need of each other's du'as. And don't forget also the people who are starving are less fortunate than us all, inshaAllah ta'ala. If anybody has any questions in these last few moments, inshaAllah, otherwise we're going to call it a day, inshaAllah.
You mentioned a lot that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always wants us to repent, and those that come back repenting continuously. A lot of us, well, from what I've seen, we say astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah many times, even throughout the day. Like, you know, the Prophet said it many times, many times,
1700, yeah.
Yeah, so what, for us that are doing that, or trying to repent to Allah, we always have to link that repentance to a sin? Because you can make, you can just say it.
Yeah.
So what's the case with that?
Okay, Jameel, our brother, he mentioned that a lot of time when we do istighfar, when we say astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah, it's always because of a sin that we committed, right? Yeah. So you're basically asking, how can we like carry on doing istighfar, right? Because other than the sin.
Exactly, yeah, that's right, yeah. Can you just make astaghfar?
No, of course. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, إِنِّي لَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ فِي مَجْلِسٍ سَبْعِينَ مَرَّةٍ. I say astaghfirullah 70 times in a sitting, and he came with someone 100 times. And he comes with so many other benefits. Nuh alayhi salatu wa salam, what does Allah Azza wa Jalla quote him saying? Telling his people, فَقُلْتُ اسْتَغْفِرُوا رَبَّكُمْ إِنَّهُ كَانَ غَفَارًا. He said, I told my people, do istighfar, for indeed he will forgive you. He's ghaffar. يُرْسِلِ السَّمَاءَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِدْرَارًا وَيُمْدِدْكُمْ بِأَمْوَالٍ. He's going to send down the rain upon you without no stop. وَيُمْدِدْكُمْ بِأَمْوَالٍ. He also what? Gives you wealth. Istighfar, my brothers and my sisters, is one of the ways of increasing the money that you have. We know that the risk can increase and it can decrease as well. That's a discussion for another. I've got a lecture online, it's called 10 Ways of How to Increase Your Provision. You'll be a rich man after that. Said, وَيُمْدِدْكُمْ بِأَمْوَالٍ وَبَنِينَ. He's going to give you kids. Again, this is an advice to those who might be struggling to have kids. وَيُمْدِدْكُمْ بِأَمْوَالٍ وَبَنِينَ وَيَجْعَلْ لَكُمْ جَنَّاتٍ وَيَجْعَلْ لَكُمْ أَنْهَارًا مَا لَكُمْ لَا تَرْجُونَ لِلَّهِ وَقَارًا. And he will also give you what? Rivers in paradise. And also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he tells us, وَأَنِسْتَغْفِرُوا رَبَّكُمْ ثُمَّ تُوبُوا إِلَيْهِ يُمَتِّعْكُمْ مَتَاعًا حَسَنًا إِلَىٰ أَجْلٍ مُسَمَّى. And then Allah says, وَيَزِدْكُمْ قُوَّةٍ إِلَىٰ قُوَّتِكُمْ. There's been a lot of discussion, right? Shall we fast while we have exams and not, and everyone is speaking about it. Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, sometimes my brothers and my sisters, he used to continue his fasting and he wouldn't break it. So one time a companion came up to me and said, after the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, nobody can do it, only me. He said, but you fast. He said, inni lastu mithlakum, I'm not like you guys. Inni ut'amu wa usqa, I am fed and I'm also what? My thirst is quenched. Was the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam eating? No. We know through istighfar and dhikr, my brothers and sisters, Allah Azza wa Jalla can what? Give you strength. And the sins, what it does is, it weakens the body and it hardens the heart. This is why Malik ibn Dinar rahimahullah ta'ala says, إذا رأيت قساوة في قلبك ووهنا في بدنك. If you now begin to feel hardness in your heart, and also you begin to feel weakness in your body, وحرمانا في رزقك, and also you feel like you've been deprived in your provision, فعلم أنك تكلمت فيما لا يعنيك. Then know that you have spoken about or you've indulged in something that doesn't concern you. Are you with me, guys? Can you see the effects of sins? And Allah tells about istighfar, it gives you strength after strength. One time Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala, he was sitting in the masjid. And he kept on remembering Allah Azza wa Jalla to the midpoint of the day or of the nahar. Around maybe, let's just say for example, if Fajr is at 4, Dhuhr is at 12, until the midpoint. So Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah came up to him and he sat down with him. When he finished, he looked at him, said to him, هَذِهِ غُدْوَتِي وَلَوْ لَمْ أَتَغَدَّ سَقَتَ الْقُوَّايَ. This is my lunch. Him doing dhikr is my lunch. Are you with me, guys? And if I don't have my lunch, then my strength is going to drop. Can you see that, guys? So istighfar comes with a lot of benefits. Maybe inshallah one time we'll do a lecture on it. The benefits of istighfar and how it has a positive impact on your, not just only on your life, but also on your akhirah. Any other question, guys?
No. What would you say are some of the signs of a person whose Ramadan is accepted and his good deeds are accepted in general?
Like I mentioned, you know, from the signs of an accepted action is that a person, he follows it up with another good deed. He continues the goodness that he was doing. And inshallah, he will have an idea which direction this individual is going as a Muslim. And with regards to his relationship with Allah Azza wa Jal. If he just read the Quran a little bit and then abandoned the Quran, do you think that his Quran now, his recitation will be accepted? That's what Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala mentioned. And also the fact that you look down at it. You don't see much of your actions. Keeps you on your toes. You continue one after the other. Yeah?
You know that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was disgraced and he'd asked about Jannah, he'd ask for it and seek it from the fire. Can we do that behind the Imam or is that only for the Imam?
The brother is asking with regards to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asking Allah Azza wa Jalla in the ayat, and because he used to sometimes stop and make and ask Allah Azza wa Jalla. He's referring to the hadith of Hudhayfa. Hudhayfa radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he says, Sallaytu ma'a Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, fama marrat bi ayatu rahmatin إلا وقف عندها يسأل ولا آية عذاب إلا وقف عندها استعيد. Every time he came to an ayah, a verse that speaks about rahma, he would ask Allah Azza wa Jal for it. And when he came to the ayah of adab, he would seek refuge from it. And this hadith was narrated by the Khamsa, Abu Dawood, Tirmidhi, Al-Nasai, Ibn Majah, and also Imam Ahmed. واضح؟ So he's saying, can we do that behind the Imam? The answer is no, that's for the Imam. That is for the Imam. Because you as an individual, you have to listen to what the Imam is saying. I know the scholars, they differ with regards to whether one can read the Fatiha or not. You have Imam Ahmad rahimahullah ta'ala, also Imam Abu Hanifa, who say you need to keep quiet, not say a word, and listen to the recitation. This is with regards to the book of Allah Azza wa Jalla. When the recitation, you can't even read the Fatiha. And they have a very strong point. You have the hadith of the Messiah when he said, La salat liman lam yaqra bi umm al-kitab. There is no salah for the person who doesn't read with the Fatiha. Right? Yes. But then you also have the ayah where Allah says, وَإِذَا قُرِيَ الْقُرْآنُ فَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ وَأَنْصِتُوا لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ. When the Quran is recited, listen. And keep quiet. You with me, guys? So Imam Ahmad rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, أجمعت الأمة على أن هذه الآية في الصلاة. The scholars have agreed that this ayah is speaking with regards to the salah. Also Imam Ahmad rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, you have a lathe in Egypt. Lathe. Nusa'd, you have him in Egypt. You have Sufyan al-Thawr rahimahullah in Iraq. You also have Malik, Imam Malik rahimahullah ta'ala in Medina. And you also have Sufyan al-Thawr in Iraq, Malik in Egypt. Na'am, and al-Awza'i, you have him in Sham. These are the four corners of the world. They never ever told somebody who does not recite the Fatiha behind the Imam that his salah is batil. But anyways, this is an issue that even you find Ibn Umar, also Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, there's a number of the companions who held this opinion, view, that you don't recite behind the Imam. You see? I know I'm going on a bit of a tangent here, but the point of the matter is, this is with regards to the Book of Allah Azza wa Jalla, he can't speak. Many scholars, they held that view. Companions held that view. So anything other than that, you shouldn't be, huh?
Let's stop there, shall I go with?
Said he wants another question. It's me, Alta. I don't need two minutes.
Okay,
enough. I think I've lost my voice. I'm leaving, so I'll wait for him. My voice is gone. Well, like guys, always a pleasure. And I always say this, Luton's one of them places where I love to come to. You know? My iman goes up when I see you guys.